Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Ralph Casa. I'm the president of the Pacific Forum CSIS. We're the poor country cousins of the CSIS here in Washington, but we do have the benefit of living in Honolulu, which is slightly warmer than it is here in D.C. this morning. We tried to bring some of the Hawaiian sunshine with us. I think it arrived yesterday, but disappeared already this morning. We're delighted to have you all with us. This is our 20th anniversary of our U.S.-Japan security seminar. 17 out of the 20 meetings have been held in San Francisco, but for the 10th anniversary and the 20th anniversary, we've done our meeting here, and also the 50th anniversary of the alliance, we did it in Washington. So we're not unfamiliar with the D.C. environment, and we thank you all for coming. As we have done in the past when we've done our meetings in D.C., we've tried to have an opening public forum in the morning to expose a larger audience to the importance that we all share of the U.S.-Japan alliance being the foundation for American security policy in East Asia. We have run our conference through good times and bad. We started out during a period of Japan passing, went through Japan bashing, Japan surpassing, and now we are, I think, at a point where once again the alliance is sometimes hitting the front pages. Today there are a couple of distractions. The Malaysian Airlines, of course, our hearts go out to all of those people who still are unaware of what has happened, and of course the situation in the Ukraine, which is tying up, of course, many of our national leaders. But we want to remind people that at the end of the day, it's still the U.S.-Japan alliance that provides the foundation for security in the Asia-Pacific region. We have an all-star cast here to speak with you this morning. Ambassador Secretary Armitage is in traffic on his way here. He said for us to go ahead and start without him, and he will make a grand entrance at some point shortly. But we thought we would go ahead and get started. For the last 5 or 6 years, I guess, I've been grateful to have as my co-host for these meetings Ambassador Nogami from JIIA in Japan. And I would invite him to make some opening comments at this point, Nogami-sensei.
Thank you, Ralph. My name is Yoshiji Nogami. I'm president and director of Japan Institute of International Affairs, a think tank in Tokyo. As Ralph put it, this is the 20th anniversary session of this U.S.-Japan security seminar, which has been going on for as I said, 20 years. During the past 50-odd years, U.S.-Japan Security Alliance has been going through the bumps and up and down and bumps and all these difficult situation. And this year as well, I think as we hear from distinguished panelists this morning, we would go through perhaps yet another testy year when it comes to U.S.-Japan security relationship. This is an important year for the U.S.-Japan alliance. In the practical term, both governments agreed to go through the revision of the U.S.-Japan defense cooperation guidelines, which is going to be revised by the end of this year. The previous revision was in 1997, and the situation has seen a sea changes. No pun intended, but there is a sea change. And on the part of Japanese government, I think Prime Minister Abe is going to go through this new interpretation of collective self-defense right. Which would certainly expand the scope of cooperation between the two countries in the area of security cooperation. On top of that, Prime Minister Abe has to go through a more fundamental task, that is strengthening the Japanese economy, which is a cornerstone of the Japanese quote-unquote power. So on the Japanese front, there are lots of tasks ahead of us, and also the on the U.S. side, I think as Ralph briefly mentioned, there are a number of issues, including Ukraine and others. But one big task is, as the recent opinion polls show, that the general public here is no longer interested in outside affairs. You know, about two-thirds of the population say that stay out of the mess outside of the United States. So this is going to be perhaps a very important challenge for two countries. And for the next day and a half, we're going to tackle these difficult situations. And by going through all these difficult tasks, I think our relationship, particularly the security, that U.S.-Japan security relationship would be once again re-strengthened. Having said that, I would like to ask the Ambassador Sasae, the Japanese ambassador, to say a few words at the outset, yes, okay. So, let's move on to the first half of the session, this public session.
Good. Again, and we're very honored to have Ambassador Sasae with us. Thank you, sir, very much. We will, at the conclusion of this open session, we will then sort of force the principals from our conference into labor, not only this afternoon, but all day tomorrow, in closed door, what has traditionally been very frank discussions on the alliance. We do publish sort of summaries of the key findings of each of these meetings. They're available on the Pacific Forum website, which is part of CSIS websites. You can either search for us through the CSIS.org or go to pacforum.org and find that information. Before introducing our speakers, I want to just do a very quick commercial. I think many of you are already on the Pacific Forum's mailing list and get our PACnet newsletters. If you're not and you put a card in the bowl out front, we will make sure you're on our mailing list. You will also see a lot of young faces in the crowd. Pacific Forum has a young leaders program where we bring young people essentially age 22 to 35 who are interested in foreign policy to our various conferences. We will have a group of about 20 young Americans and Japanese who will be sitting in on the conference in the next 2 days, and then they will meet separately. Actually, they have a program on Sunday and then all day Monday to talk about what they've heard and come up with better solutions than the old folks have managed to come up with. So if you're between 22 and 35, or if you know young people who are interested in foreign policy, please let us know, let one of the ladies out front know, or talk to myself, and we're happy to give you more details. You'll also find them on our website. We also have fellowships at Pacific Forum, particularly fellowships for people who are interested in pursuing learning more about the U.S.-Japan relationship. We each year bring one Japanese to Pacific Forum. He or she will spend 5 months with us in Honolulu and 1 month in Washington learning about the alliance. And one American who will spend 5 months in Honolulu and 1 month in Tokyo, again doing research project on the alliance. Information on all of those things is available on our website, so please or see to any of us from the Pacific Forum, and we're happy to provide you with more information on it. We have sort of arbitrarily broken the session into alliance challenges and alliance opportunities, although I think all challenges have opportunities in them and vice versa. What we will do is have our first two speakers speak. We'll take initial Q&A. Then we'll take a break, and then we'll come back, have our second two speakers speak, and then do a Q&A essentially for all of them. So let me ask Professor Takihara who is a professor at the University of Tokyo and also an adjunct fellow at JIIA, if he would begin with his opening remarks, please, Sensei.
Thank you very much, Ralph. It's an honor to be given this opportunity, and it's an honor to be acting as first batsman, as it were. But don't expect me to play as well as Ichiro Suzuki. So the session, the first one is on challenges, and I am going to focus on China, because China is the largest concern of Japan. For example, China hasn't stopped sending its government vessels to the territorial waters around the Senkakus. Its defense budget increase was a big one once again this year, which was announced at the National People's Congress. It reached 12.2%, and this compares with other expenditure items such as social welfare and employment, which saw an increase by 9.8%, education 9.1%, energy saving and environmental protection 7.1%. So you can see that defense has got the lion's share. Now, in discussing China, I am going to talk first about its politics and its society, because there is a close linkage, as I see it, between these areas and China's diplomacy and security policy. I think the domestic political scene, what's going on there, and also in society, has a lot to do with how China's been behaving in the international scene, particularly in recent years. So let me begin by touching on politics. Now, it is widely known that Xi Jinping, the General Secretary and the President, the leader of China, is in the process of consolidating his power base. I do think that is what's going on. But the way he's conducting this is actually rocking or shaking the party in a very violent way, as it were. On the one hand, he is setting up new organs in the party and in the military also that have the commanding height over a wide range of areas, and Xi Jinping is becoming the head of all these new organs and taking control of them. This is very important because a general secretary, compared to the chairman of the party in the past, you know, Mao Zedong used to be the chairman of the Chinese Communist Party, but the Chinese Communist Party abolished the chairman system in 1982 because the chairman has immense power. And reflecting on what happened during the Cultural Revolution, too much concentration of power on one person is not good, they thought, so they switched over to the general secretary system. And usually a general secretary does not have so much of a concentration of power. But that's one thing that Xi Jinping's doing now. But on the other hand, as you I think have been reading in the press, in the Western press and the Japanese press also, he's hitting and detaining the so-called big tigers on corruption. We all know about Bo Xilai, the former party secretary in the Chongqing city. And now there's Zhou Yongkan, who used to be the boss of public security apparatus, who also used to be a standing committee member of the Politburo, a very big tiger. And now, at this moment, the focus is set on a man called Xu Caiho, who used to be one of the vice chairmen of the Central Military Council. And even Li Peng, the former prime minister's family, there have been rumors about corruption surrounding that family as well. So the political atmosphere in Beijing at this moment is extremely tense, so I hear. And the situation, the political situation on that level is rather volatile. But even if Xi Jinping succeeded in winning all these battles, and even if he prevailed, that does not necessarily mean that the party can be united. The party can be unified. Why do I say that? Because I can see that there are very deep divisions within the Chinese Communist Party over many serious issues that could define, as it were, the direction of China, the direction of Chinese development. And I can give you many examples of all these issues, but briefly, let me discuss this by taking up the three reforms that Wen Jiabao, the former prime minister, repeatedly emphasized while he was premier. The first reform that he repeatedly argued for was to break the oligopoly of the state-owned enterprises. You know, the state-owned enterprises have an oligopoly in many key sectors, the so-called key sectors of the national economy, such as finance, banking, energy, telecommunication, transportation. And Wen Jiabao tried many times to break this oligopoly system. At one point of time, he even tried to apply the anti-monopoly law on the telecommunication sector. But all these efforts were in vain. And secondly, he argued many, many times about distributional reforms. We all know how skewed distribution of income is in China at the moment. The Gini coefficient, which represents the level of inequality in income distribution, according to the official announcement, it was 0.47. Some academics in China have found out, according to their survey, that it had reached even 0.61, which is extremely high. And the international level over which the society gets unstable is 0.4. You know, the bigger the figure, closer to one, the more unequal the income distribution is. So China's income distribution is a very serious potential political problem. And Wen Jiabao was one who tried many times to rectify this, but in vain. And what's happening in China now is that the rich continue to be rich, the children of the rich become rich, the children of the bureaucrats become bureaucrats, and the stratification of society is such that the so-called Chinese dream is almost shattered. You know, the individual dream of a Chinese who want to make way in life through toil and sweat, it's very difficult now. In the 1980s, there was a lot of hope that reforms can be implemented in many areas, including political reform. So people had a lot of hope. In the 90s, that's after the Tiananmen incident in 1989, the dream of a political reform was shattered. However, marketization was promoted very forcefully, and there was the Chinese dream. Even if you were born as a poor peasant, with toil and sweat, you could make way in life. However, let's say in the past 10 years or 15 years or so, this Chinese dream is almost shattered. And as I said, the children of the rich become rich, children of the bureaucrats become bureaucrats. That's a saying that is very prevalent amongst the Chinese people now. The third reform that Wen Jiabao argued forcefully was political reform. Because all these questions about distribution, about the state-owned enterprises, it all relates to the vested interests that have taken root in society. So Wen Jiabao quoted Deng Xiaoping. The great leader Deng Xiaoping argued in 1986, very forcefully and repeatedly, that without political reform, there will be no thorough economic reform. He understood very well that the vested interests in the system, especially in the bureaucracy, would resist all these efforts for systemic reform in society. And therefore, Deng Xiaoping argued in 1986 that political reform must come along with economic reform. Otherwise, the economic reform is not complete. And Wen Jiabao repeatedly used this phrase. However, we all know that nothing substantial happened. Now, it is true that Xi Jinping is trying. He's trying to introduce reforms in many areas, as we saw in the so-called third plenum, a big meeting of the Chinese Communist Party that was held in November last year. And he's trying to do what he can, I suppose. But I would say that power concentration on him is yet to reach a level that allows him to cut into the vested interests and implement the essential reforms in the core part of the system. And secondly, I am also, I have to say, skeptical at this moment that Xi Jinping has the will to do so. It's not only a matter of capability, but also whether he has the will to implement these substantial reforms of the core part of the system. An interesting case is the question of universal values. The official position of the Chinese Communist Party is that, yes, there is such a concept. We acknowledge the concept of universal values. So China has signed the UN Convention on Human Rights, both A and B. But the way Deng Xiaoping used to put it is, because we are a developing nation, we cannot implement all the human rights that are written in our constitution. You have to be patient and wait, but we will get there after we develop. And this is the conventional position of the Chinese Communist Party, which had been succeeded by Jiang Zemin, by Hu Jintao. But since, let's say, 5 years ago or so, five, 6 years ago, there has been another voice that emerged in the Chinese Communist Party. No, no, there is no such thing as universal values. Human rights, universal values, no. Human rights are Western values, but the Western people are calling them universal values to impose them on us. And this is not acceptable to China. It will destroy Chinese values. We should not fall into the trap of the West. And surprisingly, I would say that in the Central Propaganda Department, which oversees ideology, education, media, a very powerful organ in the party, the main argument now there is that they deny universal values. So it was very surprising in January 2011 when Mr. Hu Jintao, then president, came to Washington, had a meeting with President Obama, and held a joint press conference in the lawn of the White House. And there, Mr. Hu said very clearly in the Q&A session that he acknowledges universality in human rights. I was a bit surprised because I knew that the debate was going on. But the way Xinhua News Agency, the state-owned agency under the Central Propaganda Department, the way they reported this, it was rather interesting. They reported that there was a joint press conference. They distributed photographs of the press conference, but they did not report what Hu Jintao said. So this is unthinkable in any communist party all over the world, because they are under this Leninist principle of democratic centralism, and these things should not happen. But it does show, signify, how deeply divided the Chinese Communist Party is at this time. So without, and Xi Jinping's position, I was going to say that. Yeah, Xi Jinping apparently does not acknowledge that there is such a thing as universal values. It seems he's more inclined towards the conservative side, and that makes me rather worried. Now, without respect for human rights, I don't think there will be any rule of law. And China's social order at the moment remains to be based on crude power and not on law or norms or ethics. I call this order Pax Communista because it is based or it is supported by the outstanding power of the Communist Party. Now, how do the Chinese public view this situation? I would say that the public is dissatisfied with the present and anxious about the future, despite the surge in their per capita GDP. Why? We are all familiar with all sorts of social problems that the Chinese are facing at this moment. Income gap, I mentioned, corruption, we talked about environmental pollution, air pollution, lack of water. Now many Chinese cities are beginning to sink because they pump up too much underground water. It's very, very worrisome. And also nepotism, which is very rife, and the shattering of the Chinese dream, etc., etc., etc. We are very familiar with them. And the result has been that there is an increasing number of people believing in religion. They want peace in mind because they are worried. That's one. And two, those who have the means to do so, the rich people, they are emigrating out of the country. The emigration boom hasn't stopped. Now, what is Xi Jinping doing about this? As I said, he's trying with some reforms, promoting marketization and so on, while he is forcefully suppressing any sign of budding of dissent in society. We all, I think, are familiar with this situation. And it's so ironic that this effort, therefore, in my mind, further antagonizes both the left and the right, because by promoting marketization, it sort of aggravates income, the income gap, for example, and it makes the conservative people very unhappy. And by continuing with the suppressing of any voice against the government, and without really tackling the core problems in the system, as I mentioned earlier, and this is making the right-orientated or the reform-orientated people rather unhappy. So he really has to tackle the core issue if he really wanted to change the situation. Well, another attempt by Xi Jinping is to integrate the fragmented nation and garner support for the authorities by arousing nationalistic sentiments. And immediately after he came to power, he started talking about the China dream of realizing the great rejuvenation of the Chinese nation. What that means to me is very unclear, but I can see, I think it is the case that the China dream is a concept that substitutes, is a substitute for the Chinese dream. All right, your individual dream may be shattered, but don't worry. Identify yourself with the state or the nation, and you'll be very happy, because the nation is going to be the champion of the world. In fact, China dream, 中国梦, or 中国的夢 in Japanese, in Chinese and Japanese, this was a title of a book written by a colonel and a professor of the Defense University of China. And it was published in early 2010. And the content of it is rather chauvinistic. So I was very much shocked when I first heard these words from Xi Jinping in November 2012. Well, thus, the party is corrupt and divided, society is fragmented, but the system of one-party rule does not have the effective mechanisms to absorb and reflect different views and coordinate divergent interests. But still, China is growing, which is amazing. So let me turn to the international scene. In relation to this domestic situation, what is the nature of China's maritime advancement, which we worry about? What is the Japan-US alliance facing? Now, first, let me briefly go over the various factors in China's maritime advancement. First and foremost, of course, there is the increase in China's national power. You know, China now can do what they were not able to do in the past. And second, China now has a lot of overseas interests, and they need to protect them. Yes, that's fair, but I try to tell my Chinese friends that don't try to do it alone. And third, there is this America's relative decline, as seen by some Chinese since 2008, the Lehman Brothers shock and the world financial crisis that followed. Now, what the Chinese is targeting for in its relationship with the United States, in the so-called new type of great power relations, it seems to me, is equality with the United States. So we recall Xi Jinping's words, the latest said directly to President Obama in Sunnylands, California last June, that the Pacific is big enough to accommodate both the United States and China. Now, what does it mean? Well, at the end of the day, or at the end of the first half of the century, China wants half of it. And this also means that Taiwan is no longer the focus of contention with the United States. And Taiwan, in fact, since 2008, when KMT leader Ma Ying-jeou became president, has not been an object of tussle as far as the CCP is concerned. So next, as far as the struggle with Japan is concerned, there is another factor in China's advancement to the Senkaku Islands. And I would say it is the utility of having a tussle for unity. It works as a centripetal force in the party and in the society. According to one of my Chinese enlightened friends, he described the current situation that the government, the Chinese government, takes no rest in bringing up all sorts of issues to criticize Japan, the latest of which include accepting a court case of forced labor during World War II, which the Chinese had not been doing for decades. But now they have gone that far. And the anti-Japanese media campaign goes on, and unfortunately, it has been rather effective, I would say. Why? Because I think one reason is the general sense of frustration and irritation shared among the public provides a rich breeding ground for nationalistic sentiments and anti-Japanese sentiments. Well, some people could ask, but isn't it the case that the media literacy amongst the Chinese people is rather high? They don't believe in the reportings in the official media. I think that's true as far as the domestic reportings are concerned, because people's perceptions are formed by the daily information that they have access to. And when the government or the official media reports something about China, about the Chinese society, they, since they know the facts that surround them, they can make an easy judgment whether the reporting is true or reliable or not. But when it comes to international issues, when it comes to Japan, they do not have a reference point, and they tend to believe what the government media says. Okay, then, as China gradually expands its influence, what does it bring to us? What does it mean to us? I think here we would benefit by taking history as the mirror, as the Chinese say. Take history as the mirror. We all remember that World War II was a war in which the aggressors, Germany and Japan, were defeated. And what followed was independence of the former colonies and self-determination of former oppressed nations. And on the western side of the Cold War structure, at least, a rule-based international order emerged and was supported by the outstanding power of the United States. Pax Americana was not without mistakes, I must point out, but in the past 40 years, East Asia has enjoyed basic peace and stability, thanks mainly to the American presence in the region, and no doubt the Japan-US alliance has played a large role in upholding this order. Unfortunately, however, it seems that Pax Sinica is likely to be an extension of Pax Communista in the domestic context. If we are to make a judgment by China's recent behavior and action in the East China Sea and the South China Sea. So finally, what should Japan and the US do? We need to draw a common vision of the future, I would say. There are two paramount, permanent members of the United Nations Security Council that attempt to change the status quo by physical force, rewinding, as it were, history back into the previous centuries. This is indeed a deplorable situation. And my hope, therefore, is that when Mr. Obama next month visits Japan, he could issue a joint statement with Mr. Abe on how we should restore the world order into the shape that it should be. Restoring a rule-based order should come at the top of our agenda. And second, the Prime Minister and the President should share their notes on China and coordinate their China policy. In my view, it is of utmost importance that they take time discussing China in a candid and constructive way. The Japanese do understand what the United States is trying to do through its rebalancing policy, but we also need to know what America's policy towards China is in the bilateral context. For example, are you going to accept the Chinese concept of the new type of major power relationships? Or if you are going to do, what do you mean by that? And three, what we should be aware of is the fact that in Japan, people tend to see China and the alliance with the United States mainly in the regional context, whereas in the United States, some tend to see China and the alliance mainly in the global context. I think we need to take this possible gap into consideration always. You know, the importance and urgency of a crisis in the region may not be understood immediately in Washington, although it could have global implications. Next, do all these mean that we want to exclude China from our common future? Not at all. Quite the opposite, I would say. We need China's sustainable development and soft landing. And the Japanese government still provides ODA, official development assistance, to China for this purpose. And I know there is a reservoir of goodwill towards China in both Japan and the United States. So when we look into the future, our hope resides in the fact that there are moderate internationalists in China who share our values and our sentiments, although Japan bashing by the government, unfortunately, is likely to continue for some time. The cooperation and exchange that we have had between Japan and China in the past 42 years of diplomatic relations have not been conducted in vain. So there are many intelligent and good-hearted Chinese people playing important roles in Japanese society. And it is interesting that the number of Chinese tourists visiting Japan in January this year hit a record high. So my impression is that, finally, there is an increasing number of Chinese who love Japan no less than they hate Japan. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Our next speaker is probably best known as being co-chairman, along with Joe Nye, of the Pacific Forum's Board of Governors. He does, however, have a couple of, I think, jobs in Washington previously, including Deputy Secretary of State. Rich Armitage, please.
Well, thank you very much, Ralph. Let me start with a sincere apology to those of you in the public for my late arrival, and to my colleagues on the podium here. I hate nothing more than to be late, so I was late today, and I'm mad at myself, so sincere apologies. I want to talk for a few minutes about Mr. Abe's successes, because we all spend a lot of time talking about complaints about historical issues. I'll get to those, of course, but I think we should remind ourselves that if you look around the world stage and you see politicians on that stage, few have accomplished as much in a shorter time as Mr. Abe has. And I think it behooves us to remember that. Whether it's a Secrets Act, it might have been rolled out in a rough manner, but we do have a Secrets Act. This is going to improve our ability to share with Japan, and for Japan to share with their members of the Diet. These are good things. It's got a National Security Council, which has been a long-held U.S. Desire. I think it's a very coherent way for a prime minister to make competent judgments. Well, he's got it through. He joined TPP. This is, as we all know, not without some political sacrifice by Mr. Abe and his colleagues, and TPP, or the member nations who are discussing it, are 40% of the world's economy, and 70% of that 40 is the U.S. and Japan. So Japan stepping up to TPP was a huge, huge issue for us, and I think for Japan and for the region. We all know of his working on economic revitalization for Japan. It's gone better than some would have expected, not as well as others. It's not over. It's got a ways to go. TPP could add to it and would add to it if we're successful. But I think we should give credit in that realm as well. The 2020 Olympics has to be mentioned. If Japan gets this right, it will have the effect of, I think, increasing English capability in Japan. It will certainly have a certain amount of investment. I think it can very strongly empower women, which is something Mr. Abe talked about at the United Nations when he gave his talk. He's increased the defense spending after more than a decade of decline. It wasn't a huge amount, but at least it staunched the bleeding. And that takes some thinking. He's revised the National Defense Program guidelines. He's considering, and his colleagues are considering, ending the prohibition on the export of defense articles. I think Mr. Abe has had spectacular diplomacy in Southeast Asia and in South Asia. The image of Japan in those areas has gone up enormously. And look, at even yesterday or the day before, on a tough issue like Crimea, and an issue regarding the Russian Federation, with whom Japan had been moving toward a much more congenial relationship, the Prime Minister stood up and put his nation on the side of the West and imposed some sanctions on the Russian Federation concerning investments in space exploration and some relaxation of visa requirements. So I think before we offer criticism of the Abe administration, we should remind ourselves of how much they've done, and then look at all of our leaders and see how little they've done in most cases. Now on to the historical. You cannot mention Japan today without saying something about the historical record. No, Mr. Abe, in his recent statement about the Kono statement and concerning being humble in the face of history, I think was a very good start. And I can't overestimate the importance of the upcoming trilateral meeting in The Hague. I think our Korean friends have announced this today. But this is very important. It's a very big issue. We may be talking about North Korea in The Hague, but the implication of such a trilateral is much broader. And I think it takes courage on both sides to step up to that. And I know that our friends in Japan, for that matter, friends in Korea, are tired of listening to each other. In Korea, they call it, or Japan, Korea fatigue, and Japan fatigue in Korea. They're just tired of all the whining on issues. And I understand that. I think your American friends are tired, too. We're all tired of it. But it's not going to go away. It has to be addressed. It has to be addressed because it's a humanitarian thing to do. It's a respectful thing to do to these women who are dying in Korea. And it is in keeping with Japan, which has, in the last 70 years, taken a major stance on the world stage in respect of human freedoms and human rights and the protection thereof. You know, our nation has some experience with humility and apology. We treated African Americans terribly, and we'll be apologizing for this for an awful long time to come. For that matter, we treated Japanese Americans terribly during the Second World War, and we have apologized and will continue to face that. These are enduring issues, and they last for a long time. They take a long time to resolve. But there's another reason beyond the humanitarian and being the right thing to do to resolve this issue. Without the resolution of this historical issue, the cacophony of noise surrounding these issues is so great that the real story of Japan, and particularly the historical story of the last 70 years, can't be heard. And that's a historical record of enormous generosity, of enormous achievement, of enormous, as I say, respect for human rights and human freedoms. So there's a practical reason to respond to this issue. Now, I was asked by Ralph to talk a little bit about the challenges to our alliance. Well, I am one of those who think that today our alliance is actually troubled, and it's troubled for a lot of reasons. The first instance, I think, has to do with the awkwardness for the United States of the difficulty of the Republic of Korea and government of Japan's stance towards each other. It's very awkward for us. It's very hard to get our arms around it and try to make progress with both sides on other issues. So that has thrown a little bit of a monkey wrench, if you will, into the alliance. But the real big issue and the real troubled issue is an issue of confidence. And it's got several layers. I don't think there's much question in Japan about the confidence of our alliance at the high level, the high end, the nuclear umbrella, all-out war. I think most do understand and have confidence in the U.S. relationship in the alliance. But at a lower level, the so-called gray area, there are huge questions of confidence. And how much more so now? How much more so now that we have Crimea, which is an example of a gray area conflict, as far as I'm concerned. And is that an analogy for the Senkakus? Well, you can bet China's looking at it. I don't know how what they'll decide. But this lack of confidence, knowing what the United States is and isn't going to do and what we should do together, I think is really interfering in our relationship. It's gotten so that for the first time in my experience, the Japanese diplomats and politicians, but mainly diplomats, are actually parsing the statements of all of our senior leaderships, seeing if Secretary Hagel left out one word, or Mr. Kerry forgot one phrase, or Joe Biden said X, Y, or Z. It's not historically been the case. There's been enough confidence to understand that very often U.S. diplomats, U.S. People who work in the foreign policy field are a little more careless with their statements than perhaps they ought to be. But it is, when you deal with Americans, this is what you get. But never before have we had this parsing of all the phrases. It's very troublesome. We have, I think, questions of confidence surrounding our so-called rebalancing. After all, an assistant secretary in the Pentagon the other day came out and said, rebalancing? We can't do it. It's too expensive. Well, much to the credit of the Department of Defense, they didn't trotted this lady out again and made her eat her words. But it's still bouncing around in the press. Can we afford the rebalancing? Are our budget difficulties too big? Is the President of the United States a Pacific president in fact, or just rhetorically, or just because he was born in Hawaii? Well, he's going to have an opportunity to address all these issues in the not-too-distant future when he travels to Japan, and he's going to have to address these issues, and he's going to have to persuade the Prime Minister and others that he is serious about Asia, he's serious about our commitments, he's serious about our relationship with Japan. And that's going to take a little more than rhetorical skill. It's going to take sincerity. We've also had a bit of a problem with messaging, as far as I'm concerned. And primarily, I mentioned the message from the acquisition person in the Pentagon the other day, that I think our military officials in Hawaii have had a little trouble with messaging. With all due respect to Admiral Locklear, I too am concerned about climate change. I think it's a big deal. But it's not the big issue that our COCOM, our combatant commander, should be dealing with. It is not climate change, which is flying around the Senkakus, and it's not climate change, which is firing 25 missiles from North Korea into the Sea of Japan. So I think we ought to get a hold of these mixed messages. This is another reason there is this question of confidence. How about TPP? I've just saluted the Prime Minister's decision to join the discussions, to join the negotiations. But it's hard, and I know it'll be a major point of discussion, but it'll be so important for our president to be able to persuade Mr. Abe that we are serious about exerting all of our muscle as an administration to try to get this through Congress, to try to get some sort of trade promotion authority. Without it, it's hard for me to see how Japan, or for that matter, many of the other countries, will show their whole cards in a negotiation if they're not sure that we're going to put the muscle necessary to get it through Congress into the negotiation. Finally, there's a problem, in my view, with U.S. forces in Japan. It's not that they're not fine people and whatnot, but it's the headquarters itself. This long after Tomodachi, where we learned so many lessons, we still have an administrative headquarters rather than a competent operational headquarters at U.S. Forces in Japan. Rather than having a competent operational headquarters who can address issues such as missile defense, such as humanitarian affairs and disaster relief, which from time to time has been necessary in Japan and beyond, and for planning for gray area contingencies. So this is something that this administration ought to step up to quickly. Now, Japan has, on their side, has some challenges for this relationship as well. First, one of them is the constant statements that come from various politicians in Japan. It's not sufficient, in my view, for the governor of Japan to say, so-and-so said something, and that was his personal opinion. How hard is it to add, that was a personal opinion and is not the policy of the government of Japan? So there's a messaging problem, in my view, on Japan's side. I think Prime Minister came to the other CSIS some time ago and announced to very tremendous applause that Japan was back, and he was back. And that was good. But what does being back mean? What is the Japan that we're looking for in 6 to 10 years from now? And what place on the world stage is Japan going to take and is willing to take? And without knowing the answer to those questions, it's hard to know how we can shape our alliance to do as much as we can as Americans to help Japan achieve that position, hopefully, on the world stage. I hope that our Japanese friends, notwithstanding the temporary reluctance of the U.S. commanders to move forward very rigorously on the defense guidelines, will be as muscular as possible as they enter into these debates with the United States. Now, one caution. We read in the newspapers today that Japan may be on the verge of restarting talks with North Korea. And I'm one of those who was thrilled when the Yokotas finally got some measure of relief and were able to see their granddaughter. I personally have fought for them and for the cause of abductees for some time. And I thank and salute those Diet members who have also fought for this. And maybe, just maybe, there can be a resolution the suffering of the families of the abductees. But let's be very careful, because a negotiation with North Korea and a discussion can be used as a wedge between the United States, or for that matter, and all members of the six-party talks. So we've got, this puts a premium on Japanese diplomacy and consultation with the United States, with China for that matter, with South Korea, with the Russian Federation. We've got to make sure that this does not, what is seen as a temporary success, perhaps, for Japanese diplomacy, doesn't in the long run turn into a wedge that somehow interferes. So, Ralph, thank you very much for the invitation. I'll stop there and hope I'm within the time limit. And so,
good. We'd now like to open up the floor for questions and comments. Please raise your hand. When you're identified, we would ask you to just identify yourself. Try not to make your question longer than their presentations. I see a gentleman right here in front, please. Yes, please.
My name is Yoshi Komori, and I'm with the Japanese newspaper Sankei Shimbun. Question for Mr. Armitage. Everyone agrees that the so-called historical issues could erode the foundation of the alliance, and we've all been taking comments coming from someone like you very seriously. However, when it comes to the issue of the Yasukuni Shrine, previous American administration in which you are playing a prominent role of for policy toward Asia or Japan and China, did not utter a word of criticism or even reservations about repeated visit to the shrine by then the Japanese Prime Minister, Mr. Koizumi. I think he did it for 6 years. He paid a tribute to the Yasukuni Shrine 6 years continuously. And no, it's a dead silence on the part of the administration. Furthermore, senior administration officials at the time, including yourself, were saying, quasi-publicly, that Chinese demand and opposition to the Yasukuni, Japanese political leaders' visit to Yasukuni Shrine was a part of the Chinese diplomatic sort of political strategy against Japan, designed or intended to weaken or keep or constrain or confine Japan into a politically weaker and ethically or morally inferior position. You know? And I remember hearing that kind of view from you. So I think you went even so far as to say that Japan should not cave in to the Chinese demand. But as I understand your recent comment, there have been clear changes. So could you explain to us why, what changed?
Komori-san, good to see you again. First of all, you'll notice that I did not mention Yasukuni in the historical issues, and I didn't do it deliberately. Second of all, I do say that what bothered me was not the visit to Yasukuni. What bothered me is when you're doing China's diplomacy for them. They don't have to lift a finger. But the visit itself, I don't think, is in and of itself of that high moment. And I didn't see how a prime minister who had made a campaign promise and a prime minister who was following other conservative prime ministers such as Mr. Nakasone, Mr. Koizumi, and Mr. Hashimoto, how he could help but to go. That's not the main issue, and that's why I didn't specifically reference it when I talk about historical issues. I'm only talking about the comfort women. And I think that Japan and Prime Minister do have a right to visit. If this is their religious matter, I don't think as a political matter it's such a good matter, but as a personal matter, it's fine. It's their business. And I think to the extent other countries say you can't visit Yasukuni, this brings back an understandable reaction in the minds of many in Japan, many who perhaps are not favorable right now towards the visit of a prime minister to Yasukuni. So it's a complicated issue. It's an issue in which I'm not going to spend an enormous amount of time, because I think it doesn't rise to the importance of other issues which are more immediate. I don't know if that answered the question.
Professor Takahara, you're a China scholar. You know far better than I that Xi's father conducted the first anti-corruption purge for Mao in the early 1950s, and that was clearly designed just to get rid of Mao's enemies. Is this anti-corruption purge really a purge about corruption, or is it a purge to get rid of people who are inconvenient, like Bo Xilao and some of these other people?
Hi, I'm John Harper with Stars and Stripes. Mr. Armitage, you discussed some of the issues of a lack of confidence in the U.S. rebalance. Do you personally believe that the rebalance will go forward to the extent that U.S. officials have said that it will, or do you think that budget cutbacks and other geopolitical crises will derail that? And Mr. Takahara, within the Japanese defense establishment, how much confidence is there that the rebalance will, in fact, go forward? Thank you.
Scott Harold from the RAND Corporation. Mr. Armitage, wonderful to see you again, sir. I'd like to also pick your brain on another issue that you didn't touch on. It's also a sensitive one.
Slim pickings, but...
and that is the issue of Dr. Takeshima, because, of course, the history issues, the comfort women issues, some of these can be talked about as historical issues, but the Dr. Takeshima issue is one that's very live and that continues to produce negative results without the Chinese having to do anything. And I wonder if there's any solution there that you can suggest to us. One of the issues that I've thought about that I wonder we could take your opinion on, sir, is that the JADIZ and the Korean ADIZ overlap, but over the island of Iodo, which is a submerged rock feature that the Koreans currently occupy. An adjustment to the Japanese air defense identification zone of a few miles or a few kilometers would not really hurt Japan's security very much, but could be a positive signal ahead of the trilateral summit. Would that be something that you think might be something that the Japanese would be able to consider as a SOP or as a small gesture to the Koreans, giving up something that doesn't matter in a way that would help put some forward momentum in the relationship? Thank you.
Go to Rich, and then we'll take some more questions.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mostik, for the question about Xi Jinping's father and the corruption, the big tiger beating. What does it really mean? Unfortunately, I think most of the cadres in the Chinese Communist Party are corrupt. And therefore, when they choose who to bash on, it is more or less a political choice. So I think it's more related to the power struggle that is going on at the moment. About confidence in Japan about rebalancing, I'm not really the right person to answer that important question, but my general impression is that, yes, we trust the words of the American leaders, and I don't know for sure what in concrete, how much will be done, but listening to, 60% of the fleet coming to the Pacific, et cetera, we do have high hopes on rebalancing. I don't think it's only Japan, but all the other nations facing China's rapid rise in their maritime forces and their maritime advancement all feel that the high speed of change in the balance of power is not conducive to maintaining peace in the region.
Thank you. On the question of my personal view about the rebalancing, I think the administration was sincere, but not, and went about it, however, in a very awkward manner. For instance, it was supposed to be a rebalancing not just of security forces, but of our whole being in the Pacific, foreign direct investment, trade policy, education, et cetera. We want to be a part of the life, and to the extent it's acceptable to the specific nations in the Pacific, we want to be part of their life. And we don't want to put them in a position of having to choose between us and China. That's what you pay your diplomats for. But the manner in which we went about it, for instance, when President Obama first announced his sort of rebalancing, he simultaneously, there were, Mr. Froman, our trade rep, was with him, which is a good thing. But it was simultaneous with the announcement of 250 Marines going to Darwin, Australia. So the headlines, of course, were Marines to Australia, and trade kind of fell off the talking points. So I think they're sincere, and I think they do it poorly. I'll give you another example. Our Secretary of Commerce just was out in the Gulf, and that's a good thing. But if the rebalancing is so important to the United States, why wasn't she and her delegation in Asia? Oh, she'll get around to it next summer. Well, that's not the sense of urgency that fills me with a great deal of confidence that they really know what they're doing. Other question had to do with the, if I may, had to do with Takeshima and perhaps an adjustment to the ADIS. Well, I think if Takeshima sat there and Dr. Takeshima sat there alone and you didn't have the Senkakus and the Northern Territories weren't in play with the Russian Federation, then there might be an ability to resolve it. But I can't see under present circumstances how any softening by Japan, if I can use that term, wouldn't be misunderstood in China as I just keep the pressure on and these guys will fold. So I think at present there is a relationship between the dispute at Takeshima and the dispute in the Senkakus. The suggestion you come up with about a slight adjustment to the ADIS could be quite beneficial maybe at some point in time, but it's not on for now as far as I can see.
I'm Richard Katz. I'm from Toyo Keizai. This is a question for both of you. I have a fear that the TPP negotiations could go the way of the Doha round. They just go on forever, nothing's concluded, partly because President Obama lacks political clout, even with his own party, and partly because Prime Minister Abe seems unwilling to spend his political clout on going over the farm tribe in getting serious market access on that. And the consequences of that, I think, are geopolitical in the sense of a successful TPP would, among other things, I think, help the modernizers in China and those more interested in peace and responsible stakeholders to join TPP, and that would be a very good thing for stability. So my question is, one, how do you two see the risk of TPP? Well, I should say, how do you see the opportunity for the chances for success versus the risk of it going the way of Doha? And if it does go the way of Doha, what are the implications for integrating China into the regional structure as a responsible stakeholder, helping the modernizers and those who see integration as China's way versus the nationalists?
Well, Mr. Armitage, you mentioned the six-party talks. It's been over 5 years now since these parties have met. During that time, North Korea has continued its nuclear and missile programs. What would be your suggestion of how to get this started again?
Hi, I'm a second-year science Johns Hopkins student. When you mentioned about tiredness, I think Korean public and both probably Japanese public feel the same frustration and tiredness as well. When I had like Japanese scholar in Brookings Institution a few weeks ago, we talked a lot about misperception of both countries through the media in conservative constituency. So we talked a lot about whether it's like very intentional misperception or true misperception between two public of the country. Also, I believe that it's very pragmatic matters, like you said, when we have common concerns such as China and North Korea issues. When thinking about historical issues, do you have any pragmatic approach that we can actually resolve the issue, start relationships? Someone was, I think someone was mentioning about joint statement or something like that.
I'm Kumi Yokoe of Heritage Foundation. My question to Mr. Armitage, what should U.S.-Japan alliance learn from the current situation in Ukraine? Because we, Japan have some problem of our territory of Ireland from, with China.
This is what the alliance should be doing regarding Ukraine?
Yeah, Ukraine. Yeah, learn from Ukraine.
Learn. What can we be learning from?
Well, I think the first and most obvious lesson is that this is a gray area situation. Mr. Putin didn't use overt military force. So I think it should put some impetus in our planning for a gray area situation like Senkaku. Second, what we should learn from Ukraine and Crimea is yet to be played out. I think we have to see, and Mr. Abe will see when he goes to The Hague and meets with the G7, they'll be discussing this issue at length, I'm sure, and see how much solidarity in the international community can be achieved and what effect it might have on countries which behave in the same manner the Russian Federation is. So it's an unsatisfactory answer because it hadn't played out fully. Should I go on the question of TPP?
Yes, please.
On the question of TPP, I have a fear that it could fail as well. And I was horrified to find that when Harry Reid actually surprised our USTR by saying votes weren't there and he wasn't going to bring it up. This was what was shocking to me is that we had no political strategy here in the United States. And by the same token, I think that the negotiators in Japan are actually negotiating in very good faith and are willing to make some tough decisions. However, we lack something very seriously in Japan, and that is a political strategy with primarily the LDP. I don't think we've done much, what's the word that my daughter would use, socializing of this issue with the LDP, not to the extent we should. And what would happen if we don't get a TPP? Well, there'd be a lot of nasal gazing here in the United States and in the U.S. Congress. I think China will redouble their efforts to try to get what I call their pseudo-free trade agreements with different countries, and we won't have, as we could, if there is a TPP success, bring China more into open and transparent trade policies. So there's a lot at stake, and I think we've got a lot of work to do.
Well, I can't pretend I have the capability to gauge the level of risk in the failure of the TPP negotiations, but as an ordinary citizen living in Tokyo, I really hope that we can make this happen, and we need this pressure in order to reform the Japanese system in a fundamental way. And I think if we are successful, it will impact upon the thinking of the Chinese leaders very much.
Thank you. Dong Huiyu with China Review News Agency of Hong Kong. And my question is for both of you. And actually, it's a follow-up question on Ukraine. Do you think the new development in Ukraine and Crimea situation and the tension between the United States and Russia will have any geopolitical implications for U.S. rebalancing strategy and the U.S.-Japan alliance, and also China's strategic in the Asia-Pacific area? Thank you.
I'm Michael McDevitt, and my question is for Professor Takahara. Professor, I was very impressed with your analysis of what's going on in China. Let me press you a little bit, though. We've got about 9 more years of Xi Jinping, assuming he remains healthy and nothing untoward happens, of him in charge. So let me ask you to forecast. What are the implications for 9 years hence for Japan and the alliance of China that's on their current trajectory under a relatively new leader? What are your worries? What should we be worried about based upon that? And I just wanted to also add for Rich Armitage here, I was happy to hear somebody publicly say, finally, that U.S. force in Japan needs to be turned into a turned into an operational planning staff as opposed to administrative staff. That's a really important thing that tends to fly under the radar.
My name is Jung Yeo-bu, a research fellow from the ASEAN Institute for Policy Studies in Seoul. My questions are both to Ambassador Armitage and Professor Takahara. With regard to the trilateral summit next week, what do you think should be the agenda for trilateral summit, and what kind of criteria would you use to see this summit as a successful one or failure?
Yes. I'm Gil Rosman, editor of the ASEAN Forum, and I have a question for Takahara-san. You've expressed a view that the Central Propaganda Department has been controlling information that demonizes Japan and opposes universal values, and that's precisely what I've seen for the last 5 years. Now that Zhou Yonggang is being attacked, do you see any sign of change? Do you see any sign of debate that would suggest that there's a Chinese discussion about maybe shifting the balance of covering both Japan and the United States in this very negative fashion?
Hi, my name is Nadia Chow with the Liberty Times from Taiwan. I have a question for Professor Takahara. You just mentioned that Taiwan seems to be irrelevant from China's point of view, especially after President Mao's, you know, took place. My question is that, first of all, there are still different opinions in Taiwan about the relationship with China. If you monitor what happened in Taiwan now, you know, students occupy the LY, you know, lawmakers, the places that, you know, demonstrators, still different voices. And the second is that, you know, some of your colleagues believe the reduction of a tension in Taiwan Strait actually helped Japan to enhance their relationship with Taiwan. And when we look back, you know, what Mr. Abe has achieved with the President Mao's government. So from your point of view, is this reduction of tension in Taiwan Strait is helpful for Japan and the Asian neighbors? Thanks.
I'm Yang Chen with International Strategy and Reconciliation Foundation. My question is to both Mr. Armitage and Professor Takahara. I think the when we discussed about this Japan-US security, we talked a lot about this political and international matters, especially from, you know, I think the state perspectives. But the other, perhaps the building block here is a sort of what kind of things could actually help and then solidify this the alliance and then security by taking advantage of non-governmental institutions. I think in China, Japan, and the U.S. And because actually, as we look back at the past, you know, decades of history between China and then the U.S. or the between you know, Japan and the U.S. Science diplomacy, for example, has made a lot of important progress. When, you know, the political wills were not complementing each other, but still many non-governmental leaders and then you know, academics and other people made good, I think, the support to make things happen. So I'd like to hear your thoughts about to what extent these non-governmental leaders or those folks in science diplomacy can help all this, you know, the security and alliance more strengthened.
My name is Kikuchi, and I'm with Washington Research. I try to cover 20th century in very briefly. If you look at the historical perspective, most of the time for about 15, 20 centuries, Japan was, let's say, a cultural student of China, even through the end of World War II, when the military dictatorship of Japan waged an aggressive war to conquer China, let's say. But going down the route now, we can easily think that the relationship between Japan and China, and including Korea, is a very historical, very, let's say, friendly relationship. And so when China changes, let's say if the scenario of Tiananmen goes the other way and China becomes an open and more democratic society, one can imagine Japan and China becoming very close, not just economically, but also politically and even militarily. Could the US, permit such a relationship, less closeness with the United States, stronger ties with China? Would that be a threat for the United States? Thank you.
There are so many questions on Ukraine, whether that's going to affect the US rebalancing policy. I'll leave it to Mr. Armitage. Forecast. Good China researchers don't forecast. But if I'm pushed to do so, the likelihood, I think, is that they will muddle through. Because listening to my economist friends, there is no sign at the moment that the Chinese economy will falter in a substantial way very soon. You know, they will. They do have the capacity to continue with their measures, like public investments and so on, to keep the current pace of growth, as it were. That's the view as of today. And if that's going to happen, I don't think there's going to be a big turmoil of any sort, not that great a social instability of a sort. However, all the serious issues that we see today will not be solved. They'll get worse and worse, but the system won't collapse. That kind of a muddle through is the most likely scenario, I think, as of today. But please forget about it. I mean, did I say that? Maybe I did. The success of the trilateral meeting, if the meeting was a very amicable one, and if all the three leaders came out smiling, that's a success in itself, I would say. But they will have to address the history issue, the comfort women issue, and I don't know, I cannot predict, I don't have the knowledge, or I'm not sure whether the governments have an idea at this moment, you know, what sort of statement or an agreement that they will come up with. So that's that. Now, Gil's question about Zhou Yongkang, how much influence did he have on the propaganda lines, the policy lines up to this point? I am rather skeptical that even without Zhou Yongkang, even without other people who are being hit and detained now, I think the structure is that leftism will be strong because they cannot solve the problems. And some people in China are bound to say that this is because of marketization. So I think the people, the main stream of the propaganda department are people who are inclined towards that. You know, it's naturally so because what is the role of the propaganda department? What is the role of the organization department? These two departments are very powerful backbones that support the one-party rule. And their job is to maintain party ideology and criticize the current situation from that viewpoint. So I don't think the propaganda line will change as far as their anti-US or anti-Japanese campaigns or lines are concerned. Taiwan, I don't think I said Taiwan is irrelevant now, but I was just trying to say that it is not the object of any tussle as far as the Chinese Communist Party is concerned, and it is not a major focus of contention when it comes to Sino-US relations. But your question is a very interesting one. Is a better Beijing-Taipei relationship good to Japan or not? I think the answer is yes and no. You know, it's yes, because as you said, now we can more openly promote our relationship with Taipei. But it's no, because now we are the only target of their struggle. Well, other reasons too, but that's the major one. Now, there was a question about the role of NGOs, the role of societal exchange, as it were, in promoting security in this part of, in East Asia. I think that's a relevant point, relevant question, and it does count. For example, in the relationship, our relationship with China, I see two aspects. One is that of fragility, you know, security issues, history issues, and so on. But there is also an aspect of resilience. There is a very resilient part of Japan-China relations. Of course, an economic exchange is an important pillar there that supports the resilient aspect, but also the societal ties. There are many, many Japanese NGOs operating in China now, planting trees, working on sanitation and education and so on and so forth. And this has not been weakened. You know, now it's the age of the age of globalization. 21st century is very different from the 19th century or 20th century in the sheer size and both quantity and quality, I would say, of the exchange that exists amongst the people at the societal level. So I think it does play a very important role. One example is that we academics in Japan just last year formed a new association of the scholars advocating renewal of Japan-China relationship. And Professor Ezra Bogle, on our first international symposium that we held about 3 weeks ago, especially flew in from Boston to take part. And this kind of effort goes on. And in that sense, I think the ball is in the Chinese court. We want to see the ball being hit back on the Chinese side.
If I understood the questions correctly, one was on the trilateral summit and the agenda. If I were involved in it, I'd have a very minimalist agenda and let the perhaps have only a safe topic such as North Korea, and I think use the if Mr. Obama, Ms. Park, and Mr. Abe should use it just to get a little more familiar with each other. If you try to load it, it will fail. So I think a minimalist agenda and a safe topic such as North Korea, Mrs. Park has good views on it. Japan has equity, so do we, perfectly safe topic. And I would further hope that possibly out of it could come one small other agreement, that is that perhaps the foreign ministers or something like that could be deputized to talk about these issues. I think this is important. Otherwise, if there's not a process that you can point to, a sincere process, let me underline that, sincere process, then I think the upcoming trip of Mr. Obama to Tokyo and to Seoul will be dominated almost solely by those issues, and we will fail to get real guidance on the big issues that we have in front of us and to be able to really communicate on all those other things, some of which I've already explained. Question on, will the Ukraine-Crimea situation have an effect on rebalancing? Well, the answer to that today is not yet, but it could have an interesting effect. I think that at a minimum, the Pentagon was hopeful to get a little relief in their budget to the tune of $30 to $35 billion. I think that will happen. So one could say that maybe, in the short to medium term, we'd have a little bit more flexibility with the defense budget, which would, at least on the security end of things, make the rebalancing a little easier. However, as you know, there are approximately 20,000 troops on the Ukrainian border, Russian troops on the Ukrainian border now, and if they were to move into Kharkiv or Donetsk or something of that nature in eastern Ukraine, this would be another kettle of fish, a whole new ball game, and that possibly could disrupt the plans for rebalancing, and that's something we'll have to see. On the question of lessons that from China gets out of Crimea, lessons for Russia, lessons for Japan, well, I think the lesson for Japan is yet to be learned. First of all, we're going to see if Crimea, to some extent, becomes a small bone caught in Mr. Putin's throat. It could. It's going to cost. He's got to provide the water. He's got to provide the gas. He's got to pay the pensioners. And Crimea is in a terrible state economically, so this is going to cost the Russian Federation a little bit. And it's going to cost the Russian Federation during a time their economy is just stumbling along, maximum 1%. So there's a cost. Right now it's a cost that Russia can bear. Whether they learn a lesson, however, that any other adventures would also have a cost, we'll see. The lesson to Japan is one I think that should redouble the efforts to try to engage the United States into these gray zone conversations, because Crimea could look a lot like Senkaku's. But Senkaku's don't have people involved in it. So maybe Senkaku's looks easier. Maybe that's the lesson China gets. I don't know. I think we're going to have to let it play out a bit and see. You said to wrap up. Was there one other, if I may?
Yeah, please. And if you want to comment on Taiwan as well.
In Taiwan?
If you'd like.
Well, only that Taiwan right now, it doesn't seem to be a bone of any contention. That the Ma and Joe administration, although they had some difficulty yesterday getting a services agreement read through the LY, and there was some occupation by students that appeared to be an organized demonstration, and perhaps certainly the business community in Taipei is much more excited about a services agreement, which would give them much more confidence about back and forth bank flows, et cetera. So from China's point of view, I think things are moving along pretty well in Taiwan, and they don't want to have much dislocated. I've got a personal view from the time of the Taiwan Relations Act, when it was enacted in 1979 until now. This is the longest time we've ever gone without a congressional notification of sales of defense equipment to Taiwan. Now, that's as much because of Taiwan as the United States. Don't get me wrong, Taiwan is not willing to have much deeper draws on their defense budget, and outside of some things which are very difficult, such as submarines, don't have many wants. So, but it is something to note. Finally, you mentioned it, sir, and I think it is something that we have to address. And I don't know the answer, so I'll just ask the question. In Sunnylands, Xi Jinping and President Obama had an excellent discussion, where President Xi tried to get President Obama to buy into the new model of great power relations. And he basically said, no, we don't do slogans or bumper stickers, which was the right answer, certainly since we don't know what is meant by a new model of great power relations. Well, apparently that has morphed through Joe Biden's trip to Beijing into, yeah, we buy into the new model of great power relationships. Well, we still don't know what we bought into, nor does China, I think. They haven't defined it either. But this is, it certainly is one thing. It's a demotion for India, for Korea, for Indonesia, for Japan. They're not part of the new model of great power relationships. I just think it's something that we're going to have to address, and I just want to leave it in front of you. Maybe one of you has the definition of a new model of great power relations, in which case I would refer you to the administration. They need the help. So.
Well, during our next session, if anyone has a definition, we will welcome that, or maybe we can discuss it over coffee. At this point, we're going to take a break, and then we'll come back, have our other two speakers speak, and then reopen the floor for questions. But please join me in thanking our two speakers for this morning. And there's coffee set up outside, restrooms around the corner.
Let us start the second half of this public panel session. I'm not really sure the task before the two speakers in this session be much easier or more difficult, but since we dealt with the various challenges that face the U.S.-Japan alliance, we would like to ask Professor Nai of Harvard University and Mr. Ikuo Okamoto, the a senior fellow at International Center for International Studies at MIT to speak on the opportunities of the for the alliance. Actually, the challenges that, we talked about give a huge hint for the underlying opportunities for the alliance. But nonetheless, I would like to ask first to speak, ask that Professor Nai to kick off the discussion.
Thank you very much, Ogami-san. I apologize if I wind up repeating a bit of what we heard earlier, because I'm not sure I understand the difference between a challenge and an opportunity. Every challenge presents an opportunity, and every opportunity seems to be a challenge. So, so there may be a bit of overlap, but I'll try to sort it out. But I want to start by saying how impressive it is to see the 20th anniversary of this Pacific Forum event. I believe I spoke at the first one in 1994 in San Francisco, and I've attended many since then. And it's always struck me as a particularly valuable chance for Americans and Japanese to get together and have conversations which are deeper and more fruitful than in many other settings. So I want to congratulate Ralph and Brad Losserman for the 20th anniversary of a successful venture. But it also gives me a kicking off place for my thoughts about opportunities, because it might be interesting to go back and ask, what were the opportunities that we saw in 1994? And indeed, what were the challenges? And it's hard to recall, but the big challenge was the end of the Cold War. And the opportunity was, what are we going to do with the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty and alliance after the Cold War? It's hard to recall the way the world looked at that time, but in Japanese public opinion in 1994, 93-94, there was a view that, particularly as the Socialist Party was becoming more important in the coalition politics of the, after the first end of an LDP government, there was a feeling that maybe the U.S. alliance wasn't needed anymore, that maybe maybe Japan should rest its security upon the United Nations. There were commissions that that looked at this internally. There was a good deal of writing about this, that that maybe the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty was a relic of the Cold War, and now that the Cold War was over, and many people felt that liberal democracy had triumphed, that this wasn't necessary anymore. The other side of this, at the United States, the Clinton administration had been elected in the 92 election on the slogan, "It's the economy, stupid." And the feeling was that Japan was destroying the American economy by what it regarded, by what the Americans regard as unfair trade practices, and that the dominant theme in the first years of the Clinton administration, first year, was largely trade disputes with Japan. So when we think back of challenges and opportunities, the challenge 20 years ago was, how do we keep this treaty alive, if it should be kept alive? And the opportunity was to think through how to do that. I can remember believing at the time, when I was in the Clinton administration, that both these views on the American and the Japanese side were mistaken. And I used a phrase that to try to explain it, which is that the growth of East Asia and the great triumph of East Asia for the prior decades before 1994 had been based on an unspoken assumption that there was security. Every economic relationship requires a security relationship. All markets require a political structure to surround them. it's very easy to take them for granted. And I argued that security is like oxygen. You don't notice it until you begin to miss it. And that, I think, was the situation in East Asia in 1994. I think the American presence in the region had provided, and the, which, of course, was based on largely on the American-Japan Security Treaty, but also the treaty with Korea, South Korea, had provided this kind of security which allowed economic growth. And the challenges that we faced were, how could you preserve this, or should you preserve it as an opportunity, faced with really two things that were changing in the region in security. One was North Korea, and the other was the rise of China. On North Korea, if you will remember correctly, this was the final days of Kim Il-sung. North Korea broke out of its obligations under the Non-Proliferation Treaty. It had 100,000 men massed within 60 kilometers of the demilitarized zone, and it provided a severe threat. And that has lasted to this day. One thing I don't think we expected in 1994 is that we would still be dealing with a totally unpredictable Kim family, which is a relic of the Cold War in a post-Cold War period two decades later. And the fact that that North Korean situation is unpredictable and still a threat is why cooperation with South Korea is such an important opportunity for the alliance now. Even if Park Geun-hye and Prime Minister Abe meet for a photo opportunity at The Hague next Monday, as many people expect, that's not going to be enough. Just to get a photo op and a little brief discussion about the North Korea and so forth isn't going to be sufficient. What we're going to have to see are steps following up on that, which actually deepen the relationship and make it possible to cooperate in case there is some unpredictable set of events arising out of North Korea. Rich Armitage mentioned earlier the problem of Korea fatigue, and many of my Japanese friends have told me that they're tired of this. But as Rich said, excuse me, it doesn't matter whether you're tired of it, North Korea is not tired of it, and you also need to pay much closer attention to this. So this strikes me as a very important opportunity for the alliance that we really have to start making some progress. Let's hope Monday is the beginning of that. The other great challenge that we faced, and similarly the opportunity, was the rise of China, which Professor Takihara described so ably in his presentation before the coffee break. It was clear that China was rising. What wasn't clear was how should we react to this challenge and what opportunities did it present? At that time, I remember working with Ezra Vogel, who's here in the front row, who is the National Intelligence Officer for East Asia. And Ezra did a very interesting assessment of the potential futures for China. It was interesting was that some futures could turn out badly, but some didn't have to turn out badly. And this affected the way in which we looked at the major options that were on the table then, one of which was to try to contain China, to hold it back before it grew in strength. And the other was to try to engage China and bring them into what Bob Zoellick eventually called a relationship as a responsible stakeholder. And as we looked at those options, we felt that there were many more opportunities on the second than on the first. For one thing, the idea of containing China was not popular in most of Asia. Countries wanted an American presence, they wanted a Chinese growth, they didn't want to have to choose. So the idea of trying to arrange containment of China was very unlikely. Indeed, I again used a phrase then which still works today, which is the only country that can contain China is China. And China, incidentally, in the last couple of years has been a pretty good job doing a pretty good job of containing itself, if you look at its relations with its neighbors, because of how it treats maritime issues in both the East China Sea and the South China Sea. But the other point about the option was the opportunity, which is if you treated China as an enemy, which containment would have meant, then you were guaranteeing an enemy in the future. But if you tried to engage China as a responsible stakeholder, you weren't guaranteed friendship, but you were at least keeping open opportunities for a better world. And our view was that to try to contain China where it wouldn't work and to throw away all the possible positive futures that were opportunities would be a mistake in policy. And the net result of that, of course, was that you found in Clinton's policy acceptance of Chinese trade, help for China to join the World Trade Organization, acceptance of Chinese students, and other social contacts. And I've always said when Chinese complain today that the rebalancing toward Asia is containment, I say go back and read your history books. In the Cold War, containment of the Soviet Union meant virtually no trade, and it meant virtually no social contacts. Instead of that, we not only have massive trade, but a massive trade deficit. In addition to that, we have 200,000 Chinese students in our universities. This is not your grandfather's containment. So I think in that sense, the option that we chose presented an opportunity for both the U.S. and Japan. But at the same time, both the U.S. and Japan needed an insurance policy. Suppose as China grew stronger, as it rose along the lines that Professor Takahara ably described, suppose they did become a bully. Suppose they did become excessively aggressive. In that case, our insurance policy for both the U.S. and Japan was to maintain the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty. And by maintaining the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty, we had something to fall back on in case our bet on an opportunity with China turned out to be a risky bet. And that, of course, was the basis of the Clinton-Hashimoto Declaration, which was issued in 1996 in Tokyo, which said that the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty is not a relic of the Cold War, but on the contrary, is the basis of stability for the post-Cold War era in East Asia. So that essentially was how we saw the opportunities 20 years ago. And in that sense, I think we were largely right. We needed to keep the U.S.-Japan alliance, and that remains true to this day. We saw that there were potential common interests of the U.S., Japan, and China working together, and that includes issues like global financial stability, dealing with climate change, issues of energy security, problems of pandemics, and so forth. There are areas where there is a joint gain game that is being played for U.S., Japan, and China. And that means that the basis of our policy, the opportunity, is one which you think of East Asia as a triangle of good relations between the U.S. and Japan, the U.S. and China, and China and Japan. And that third leg is probably the most difficult at this moment. But it's also worth remembering that if you conceive of these opportunities in East Asia as a triangle, it's not an equilateral triangle. It's a triangle in which the U.S. and Japan are much closer because we have this alliance, and this alliance essentially is the insurance policy which allows us together to cope with this historical change of the rise in the power of China. Now, in that sense, I think it's important, therefore, that among our opportunities are things that strengthen the alliance. And in that sense, I think Prime Minister Abe's program has many good things in it. Rich mentioned some of them. The Secrets Act allows us, for example, to deal more with cybersecurity with Japan. The NSC makes it easier to coordinate between NSCs. on constitutional interpretation. I think Japan has a right of collective self-defense under the UN Charter. I don't think this requires amendment, but does mean that there can be interpretation of the Constitution. After all, what are Japanese ships doing off the coast of Somalia if that's not collective self-defense? In any case, to my mind, the Abe package, whether it includes the things I just mentioned, or arms exports, or the economic programs, which include TPP, I think the package is actually good and provides good opportunities for what's needed in the U.S.-Japan relationship. My objection is not to the package, it's to the nationalistic wrapping that's over the package. It's self-defeating. Abe is essentially doing things like threatening to revise the Kono statement or Moriyama statement or his appointments at NHK or the visit to the Yasukuni Shrine, where I do disagree with my friend Rich Armitage. These are things which essentially arouse suspicions about a package which is actually a sensible package. And if the package were presented without the wrappings, it would be a lot more successful. So one of the opportunities that we face is how can we get across the things we need to do to strengthen the alliance without frightening the neighbors and without disrupting that stability of the triangle of good relations that I mentioned. If we look ahead, I think the interesting question is how likely are we to see this opportunity succeed that I mentioned. When Prime Minister Abe was at Davos, where I talked to him about some of this, he mentioned the analogy of 1914, and one of the questions we have to ask is there any danger that we could see a 1914 situation occurring in East Asia? I've written to say that this type of analogy is somewhat exaggerated. It's true that in 1914, most of the countries in Europe had high degrees of economic interdependence and did not expect war, or at least not a world war, merely a third Balkans war. So surprises can happen, but I was struck that when Rich Armitage and Steve Hadley and Jim Steinberg and I were sent by Secretary of State Clinton to call on the prime ministers of Japan and China in the October of 2012 to discuss the questions that had risen over the Senkaku, or as Chinese call it, Diu Islands. When we talked with top Chinese leaders, it was clear that none of them wanted war. None of them wanted to disrupt the relationships with Japan. One of the things that we pointed out was that if the second and third largest economies in the world got into a boycotting or tit-for-tat retaliation sanctions with each other, this would be bad for China, bad for Japan, and bad for the world economy. And I was struck that the top Chinese leaders that we talked to agreed with that. It wasn't as though they were chomping at the bit on this. But the thing that was more worrisome to us was the dangers of miscalculation, that something could arise like the situation in 2010, where a Chinese trawler smashed into a Japanese Coast Guard ship twice, not once, and led to the first great problems over, recent problems over the Senkaku Diu Island dispute. And in that case, what was interesting was the captain of the trawler was drunk. It wasn't that he had orders from Beijing to do this. He was showing how tough he was under the influence of alcohol. And yet once that happened, given the atmosphere of nationalism in Beijing and throughout the bureaucracy, it became impossible not to escalate until you finally got the embargo of exports of rare earth materials to Japan. So the danger that we were worried about as we looked at this situation was not that somebody in Beijing, like Xi Jinping, gives an order to go do something stupid. It's that somebody on the scene does something stupid, and as it escalates up the chain and is exacerbated by and magnified by nationalism, becomes very difficult to manage the problem. So the message that we gave, the three of us, four of us gave to our interlocutors was threefold. We said, first of all, don't make any mistake, there is a deterrence message here. When the Secretary of State and Secretary of Defense both say that the Senkaku Islands are covered by the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty, that is serious. The fact that we don't take a position on the ancient history, whatever happened in the 19th century, doesn't mean that we don't have a very clear position on the situation since 1972. When we handed back Okinawa in 1972, it included the Senkaku Islands, and that meant that Japan had administrative control and has administrative control, and therefore these islands are covered by the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty. Make no mistake on that. And for people who say, yes, but doesn't the current occasions in Ukraine and Crimea, doesn't that undercut that? Not at all. Notice something. What happened in Crimea and Ukraine was not determined by distant, far-off things. What was determined in those cases was local military superiority. George W. Bush certainly indicated strong willingness to use military force with his invasion of Iraq, but when Putin basically invaded Georgia and had local military superiority, George W. Bush didn't do anything about it. So if you say, doesn't this show a weakness of Obama that he hasn't used force or something in relationship to Crimea? On the contrary, what it shows is that Putin had local military superiority there. The key point to maintain is that in the Senkaku Daiyu Islands, that the United States has overwhelming military superiority if it were to come to that. And if you look at the air and naval capacities, that's something that we need to see as important for the future of the alliance. We certainly have it now. But in any case, deterrence was one message. The second message was communications. We were struck not only that Japan and China didn't understand each other very well in their communications, we were also struck that the communications between the national capitals and what was happening on the ground, not on the ground, in the sea, in the East China Sea, was often not adequately controlled. And there have been some improvements in those systems of vertical communications since then. And the third thing that we worried about was the point I mentioned earlier about nationalism and the danger of escalation when nationalistic forces are powerful in both national capitals. So as we looked at the opportunities for East Asia, the opportunities that are presented by this triangle of good relations between all three states, resting on the security of the U.S.-Japan relationship, we feel that those opportunities are there, they're strong, but to seize them, we have to maintain the strength of the U.S.-Japan security alliance. And so I think in that sense, the right answer to the challenges that we face is to make sure that we keep open opportunities by maintaining the alliance. And in that sense, there's a surprising degree of continuity between the problem we face today and the problem we faced in 1993-94. And I'm pleased to say that we rose to the challenge in 93-94 and seized the opportunity to strengthen U.S.-Japan security treaty. And I think we can do the same again today. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Knight. Now I would like to ask Yukio Okamoto to make a few. He's going to use, slides.
Thank you. Thank you, Nogami-san. Thank you, organizers. You two really did a fantastic job. Except for putting me in a hotel next to the room of a very passionate and loving couple. And if I sounded a bit too dizzy, that's because of your two fault. You know, it's always easy to speak right after Joe Nye because he structuralizes where we stand in such a beautiful manner. And I support him 100%. So I have very few to add, but looking at young faces, I am going to show you some basic slides of where things are. Something still, in my view, can be unwound and reversed. What leaders say matters very much. When the president of Korea says the relationship between an aggressor and a victim does not change for 1,000 years, that's in his in her famous speech of last March, people will easily get influenced. You see this famous picture of the U.S. House chairman kneeling in front of a comfort woman's statue in California. And this is at the heart of current Korea-Japan complexities. And, you know, Let me talk something about my personal matter. This is my mother here. She wrote a book recently, 100 years old. She is 100 years old. And she doesn't like to talk about the Comfort Women case. Says that, you know, what Koreans are accusing us is not right in many respects. At which point I will have to tell my mother, mother, that's not a correct thing you should say. You should never say a word about Comfort Women, because the system was a barbarian, inhuman, inexcusable system of bringing women to the battlefront. So we all must shut up. Otherwise, anything you say will be used against you. At which point, my mother shuts up in a very grumbling manner and changes the subject to her favorite topic, picking on my wife. Yukio, you have changed after your marriage under the bad influence of your wife and blah, blah. So at which point I leave. Just to tell you that there are many views still in Japan. Koreans have to have a more relaxed view. They have to change to believe our goodwill. This is a photo criticized by Korean media. You know why? Because of the number. Yomiuri Giants gave Mr. Abe a uniform with the number 96, because he is the 96th Prime Minister of Japan. But the Korean campaign was that, look, this is Mr. Abe's campaign to revise Article 96 of Japanese Constitution. Article 96 revision will make the revision of the entire Constitution easier. They're going a bit too far. This is what I should have shown you earlier. This is Chinese feeling towards Japan. And again, just in the case of Korean feeling towards Japan, it only starts from 2005. So before that, there were much more favorable time when Chinese people were friendly towards Japan. But now, partly because of a political orientation, especially the young people of China are really against Japan. Showing loathing, if not hatred towards Japan. And some of them have begin to carry the banner. You can see here. Ooh, sorry. Wait. Shoot. No, it's gone. Sorry. Those banners read, Liberate Okinawa, Take Back Okinawa, which seems to be the favorite slogans of young Chinese. Not every one of them, but at least diehard anti-Japan demonstrators. And of course, you know, at the heart, there is this issue of Senkaku. I just show you pictures maybe you have not seen before. These are Senkaku Islanders, Japanese, of course, who started to live there in 18th century until 1940. This is the port they have constructed. And this is a fisheries factory that existed until 1940. Chinese never lived, much less landed, on Senkaku. The first Chinese who landed Senkaku were the activists from Hong Kong in 2004. Oh, by the way, United States must bear the blame because you have bombarded Senkaku Islands for, look, 394 times. And if this was the Chinese territory, you are subject to reparation from them at a later stage. Now, the more the seriousness, in my view, is this. Senkaku Setsuya, China has a two-tier naval strategy, and which is by 2010, they will have the complete control of the waters within the first island chain, white dotted line. And by 2020, they will have what is called A2AD capability, anti-access area denial capability within the second island chain, which is here. Now, as you can see, so long as their strategy remained in their first phase, Senkaku was nothing but uninhibited small islands at the periphery of the targeted waters. Now it is different. As they enter into the second stage of their naval strategy, Senkaku sits at the gateway of their entry into the Pacific. So, military significance of Senkaku has changed dramatically, and China will not compromise on the issue. If they can get hold of these islands, they are, as they, these are the three major fleets of China, and it will be 400 kilometers closer to west as their military naval post, 1,200 kilometers closer to Qingdao as their naval supply spot. So, militarily, this is a very, very precious target. So that's why I'm saying that the issue will not come easier with the lapse of time. It will even more difficult in future years. Now, China has to do a lot of work in order to convince the international community that it belongs to them. So they have two approaches. One is to repeat the violation of Japanese territorial waters among Senkaku to show mainly to the United States that Senkaku is no longer under the effective control of Japan. Henceforth, it will not be covered by Japan-US Security Treaty, Article 5. This is Article 5. The second strategy is to discredit Japan all over the world. So, Mr. Abe's visit to Yasukuni was a very good occasion for them to tell the whole wide world, look, the prime minister, the leader, is worshiping war criminals. And they are on their global campaign. Well, look at these pictures. This is a Chinese ambassador making a campaign against Japan at the headquarters of African Union. And these nice African people don't know what happened during the World War II. So Chinese have to teach anew the atrocities of Japanese Imperial Army 80 years ago and to create a hatred or contempt among Africans on the basis of which they can say that now we have this problem with Japan and who do you believe? Us, democratic country, or Japan with militarism still in their DNA? Now, before I leave Senkaku, there is a widespread argument in the United States that we should stay away from there. Why should we get involved militarily with China? for such a small uninhibited islands. This is my purely personal view. But Japan should not ask the United States for direct military combat with Chinese Liberation Navy, creating apprehensions among American people, especially within Congress. I think it's, let's face it, foolhardy to expect Seventh Fleet to come to fight with Chinese Navy. It is solely under the purview of Japanese self-defense forces to prevent these things from happening and to deal with Chinese in the unfortunate event. But for instance, I put the picture of AWACS. United States under Article 5 must do something to jointly work with Japan. So why don't you send airplanes? Give us the information about Chinese activities. And that is one of the authentic ways for the two militaries to cooperate, falling under the purview of Article 5. So don't raise the fear among your compatriots that you will be involved in frontal war with Japan just because of these stupid, uninhibited small rocks far away from Okinawa. But that's my personal view, which I intend to promote in Japan. The alliance, I'll very go quickly. It is a sine qua non for Japan. Japan is such a small country militarily. This is Japan. And only aided by the nuclear deterrence of US forces, it is facing up to gigantic military states in Asia. We are denying ourselves. I hope Mr. Abe will be changing this constitutional interpretation to go for collective defense. But the heart of Japanese security is the alliance with the United States. And there I am feeling a bit uneasy. And I'm going to share my uneasiness frankly with you. This is a public opinion poll conducted by the Japanese Foreign Ministry and Gallup since 1970. Sorry, I can't see the Yes, but it's 1970. American opinion leaders were asked, which country do you think is the most important country partner for the United States in Asia? Those who said Japan is marked blue. Red is China. And you see in at the peak years of, sorry, again, you can't see the years, that's 94 and 95. It's here. This is 94, 95. 79% of Americans said 79 Japan, and only 12 or 14% said China. Since then, the number keeps going down and down and down. And this is when DPJ came to power in Japan. Sudden droppage. With the advent of Abe administration, it regained somewhat, but still staying at a much lower number than used to be, with 39% of people thinking that Japan is the most important partner for the United States, as against 43% saying, no, it's China. And you have to mark here, this is Korea. 14% of American opinion leaders now say it's not Japan, it's Korea, which is most important for the United States. Koreans are doing very, very effective campaigning, lobbying throughout the United States. You know, my analysis is that why did we have such high
score in 1994, 1995, with 79%. That is when Japanese economy was at the height of its strength in terms of world global share. In those years, Japanese GDP was 17.9% of the entire world GDP. Now it's down to 7%. So how United States perceive Japan, whether it's an important country or not, has a lot to do with economic strength. So I say that one of the most important things for Japan is to take back our strong economic position, which Mr. Abe is doing now successfully, and this is going for the better. For the United States, of course, you have, this is George Washington in Yokosuka. You can cover the entire West Pacific and Indian Ocean from Japan. So it is a mutual thing. And look how Japanese are feeling towards the utility of Japan-US Security Alliance. Amazing number, 81% of people support this system, as only 10% against it. In a democratic society, this is almost a unanimous support for our alliance with the United States. So from our point of view, this necessity will not change. So I put US-Japan Security Alliance is a sine qua non for Japan. But for the United States, how long it will last, that's where my uneasiness comes. As you can see from the public opinion poll conducted before. This is American feeling towards Japan, and I guess this is when there was some unfavorable time. This was during the Gulf War, when Japan was perceived as not doing anything, and of course, economic aggression as well. But on the whole, U.S. does like Japan too. I think, when I have time, I will tell you how you were wrong during the Gulf War to have put us in your dirt list. This is last year's academic winning award, ARGO, and nobody knows that there was almost a similar event during the Gulf War when we housed your embassy people, 20 of them, taking a risk from Saddam Hussein. But it was never reported in the United States. I mean, so we have a lot to do for perception review. If both sides know the story from both sides, as in the case of Iwo Jima. Now, I have prepared several more slides. So now we have assertive Abe. Oops, I'm sorry, this is September 2006. Sorry. But this time it's real. Nikkei, look how stock price has been soaring. He's doing all the good. But Japan need to overcome the agriculture backwardness to sign the TPP. And we also have to do something about this. This is how Japanese ODA, economic assistance, has been decreasing. We used to be the number one donor in the world. But with the waning of Japanese economic strength, now we are down to number fifth in the world. We have to really come back to the world stage as a very constructive economic system. Now, question of confidence, this is because Joe used this word, so I quickly changed the title, but since I'm running out of time, I will save it for the next time. But Japanese have grown, one more, yeah. from lopsided relationship 68 years ago. It's very easy to count because I am 68 years old, born when the war ended, so I know how many years have elapsed between the two when we started, since we started the new relationship. Japan always looked up to the United States as a big and benevolent brother. And as you saw, 80% of Japanese love the United States. By the way, which this is one of the highest percentage of friendly feeling towards the United States throughout the world. And on the basis of that friendship, I think there are a lot of opportunities. But today I had no time to, although I prepared some slides, which I'll be happy to answer if you have questions. We have to face historical issues square. I think what we did in China and in Korea has been exaggerated, but still we invaded China, did a lot of atrocities, no ethical excuse can be made there, and we have to teach those things to our kids. I teach at Japanese universities, and it is amazing how little they know it's got to do with defective high school education in Japan. So it takes time, but for instance, in China, the so-called sixth generation, who are in their 40s, will come to power at the 20th Party Congress of 2022, and there will be more neutral views. Takahara-san can say a few words, but there will be a generational change. And since I have been explaining to you, the sudden deterioration is the product of the last decade or so. I'm not that pessimistic, and I'll stop here. Thank you.
We have about 20 minutes, and if you would like to ask comments or questions, microphone is coming to you, and please make your identify yourself and make your question succinct and short, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Jin Nguyen with Voice of Vietnamese Americans. I thank Professor Nai and Mr. Okamoto and also the whole panelists, especially Mr. Takahara. My question has to do with US-Japan security, and it has to do with Asia-Pacific, but moreover, it has to do with the global security, because I think we now all in together globally. As Mr. Okamoto has talked about the first island chain and the second island chain, it has a lot to do with our security. And I also applaud Dr. Nai, Professor Nai, about the thinking that opportunities and challenges are one. And you made it very clear that deterrence and the insurance policy is key. So my question has to do with Asia Pacific, and Prime Minister Abe had made it clear that East China Sea and South China Sea are interconnected, and so does the Indian Ocean. My question to you is, in the context of ASEAN, is there a good deterrence, a good insurance policy that Japan and US can cooperate with South Korea also maybe? Would there be a potential ASEAN, Japan, US, South Korea security treaty as an insurance package to ensure the policy, the security of the region, so we can have a strong market, a strong and long-term sustainable trade among the regions in which China will benefit? Thank you.
I will collect a couple of more questions and ask the panelists to respond.
Hi, Mike. I'm Michael Meserve. I'd like to ask, following up on Mr. Armitage's observation that the U.S. Forces Japan has to switch from an administrative to an operational command, and in particular, the theme of your panel, opportunities, what would your ideal action plan be for the next 10 to 15 years to operationalize command and control and the relationship between the self-defense forces and U.S. Forces Japan? In particular, what would the United States have to do in terms of budget? What would Japan have to do in terms of collective self-defense? And what, more importantly, what we have to do for protection of classified information?
I'm Kumi Yokoe of Heritage Foundation. My question is to Professor Nai on opportunity to make U.S.-Japan public diplomacy collaboration. Now, Washington, D.C. has Sakura Festival. There are many ideas related to public diplomacy to make U.S.-Japan strong alliance strong. How do you think U.S.-Japan public diplomacy can be a good tool for the mission of U.S.-Japan alliance?
I would like two panelists to respond. First, Okamoto-san.
Yes. I drew this picture. I will too much simplified, but this is something we should avoid, which is the confrontational relationship between continental Asia and maritime Asia. I define maritime Asia as Japan, Korea, Taiwan, Philippines, Vietnam, Singapore, Indonesia, Australia, who are increasingly threatened by Chinese expansionary maritime strategy. It is important that these countries get together and not necessarily to form anti-China camp, but to exchange views and information, sort of a loosely knit international society. Otherwise, Chinese strategy of divide and conquer will have to be very careful. There is a very interesting article published just a month ago by a man named Mr. Chen Shen Yang, who said a very, very interesting thing. We have to exploit the weakness of Japan, who have a severe natural disaster, still suffering from nuclear fallout, who has very shallow strategy, aging society, lack of energy and resources, but still they are still a strong country. So in order to completely overwhelm Japan, we need more patience. And let's encircle Japan with international allies who fought against fascists during the World War II. China has to cooperate with Korea. China has to cooperate with Russia. And the United States, very important. Japan is too much dependent on the United States, but the US not so. We have to drive a wedge between US and China. Make US understand for the larger cause to unite with China and cut off the small differences they have with China. So, I mean, very well thought strategy. If I were Chinese, I would write the same article. And this is exactly what China is doing. So, fine. 10 years ago, your questions are already pertinent, how we could bolster Japan-US security relationship more. Of course, we have a joint exercise. Japanese are wanting to go out to the world, Indian Ocean, Iraq, and so forth. But now, the most important thing is, as I told you, we have to have completely perceptual concurrences between Japan and China that this alliance is needed. And then with the recovering Japanese economic strength, we'll be able to develop much sounder relationship. Already your forces in Japan, you can keep them at a cheaper cost than even keeping them in the continental United States, because you have to pay your soldiers' salaries, but all the utilities, labor cost, and other expenses are borne by Japan. I think this is a very good arrangement, and Japan should even increase our host nation support more. So it will come as a general evolution of according to the increase of Japanese recovery. But more important, that we really did not talk between Japan and the United States, the issues of history. We always thought historical issues are something we have with China and Korea, but no, we really have to come to a popular understanding of where we are, and Japan, as I said, has to change its education. Thank you.
Professor Nye?
I think the Yukio is right that there is a Chinese strategy imaginable of trying to unite the region and drive a wedge between the U.S. and Japan, but the Chinese can't do it. One of the problems that the Chinese have is that they're captured by this rising nationalism inside China, and this goes to the kind of strategy that they could organize. I've had this discussion with Chinese high officials and with fellow academics, but let me give you an exchange with an academic. I said, you know, if you were really interested in improving your relations with your neighbors, you shouldn't do things like take Scarborough Shoal from the Philippines. I said, what did you do with Scarborough Shoal? You went and you pushed out the Philippines fishing ships. You now control Scarborough Shoal. So you used your hard power and you won a little atoll. In the meantime, you lost all your soft power in Manila. No matter how many Confucius Institutes you start or whatever other propaganda you try in Manila, people remember that you took Scarborough Shoal. And this professor said to me, I said, this is a counterproductive strategy. I mean, you're winning the little things and losing the big things. And this professor said to me, you're right, but we had no choice because it was a matter of sovereignty. Now think about that. Think about the number of little atolls, rocks, and things in the South China Sea that China sees as an issue of sovereignty. And imagine what that means when you try to develop a strategy such as Yukio described. They can't do it. They can't do it because internal nationalism means the sensible foreign ministry official who says, let's give them Scarborough Shoal. It's more important that we're, you know, have soft power in Manila. That person has said, oh, you can't. Think of the 100 years of humiliation since the Opium War. You can't possibly do this. So China is stuck with a really difficult problem. And if I were, which is that it's very hard for them in a rising nationalism at home to make the accommodations with their neighbors. And they have, what is it, 22 neighbors? It's not just the Maritimes. They also have problems with India on a border as well. And over the period from 2009 to 2000, to today, really, their relations with many of these neighbors have gotten worse. Vietnam, Japan, Philippines, India, This is, you know, this is not a very impressive record in foreign policy. But they have a hard, and if you point this out to them, they have a hard time figuring out how to do something about it. So if, to go to your question about if I were a Southeast Asian country, what would I do? I would insist that China implement the code of conduct for negotiations over these islands in the South China Sea that officially gives up this nine dashed line, and on the questions of particular territories' willingness to negotiate in a multilateral context. Chinese want to keep it bilateral so they can throw their weight around. But if the ASEAN countries would hold together, they could hurt China in its soft power, which is where they're at their most vulnerable. So a strategy for ASEAN would be to say, live up to what you signed in 2002, and let's have this multilateral framework. And I think that would make it much more difficult for China to accomplish what it's trying to do in regard to the South China Sea. As for the U.S.-Japan alliance and the future of it, I do think that there's something in Rich Armitage's point about having operational command, not just administrative command. But I think, frankly, the politics is much more important. There are operational things and exercises important. I think the fact that Japan and U.S. exercised at Camp Pendleton this past fall on how to recapture islands, well, good. Good signal of developing a joint capacity on something that isn't going to be lost entirely in Beijing. But I do think that the much more important thing is the extent to which the U.S. and Japan are able to keep their political consultations together and having a feeling that you don't have misunderstandings. Every time a Yasukuni shrine occurs, it gives the Chinese a place to put that wedge in. Every time somebody talks about the Kono statement, even with Chief Cabinet Secretary Suga's statement that we're just looking back at the facts of this, why do it? Japan is a peace-loving country with a perfect record for the last 60 years. It should be looking ahead and proving that that's its position, not going back and rehashing its weak point, which is history. And that's what I meant when I said earlier that I have no objections to Abe's package. I just think the wrappings are counterproductive. It's like giving somebody a present and wrapping it in used newspapers or something. It's from the 1930s. It's not a smart strategy. So I think that we ought to focus on the political questions of the alliance and not so much, I mean, I'm all in favor of making changes on the operational side, but I think it's this capacity to show that U.S. and Japan are one and close, which is more important than the details of the military operations.
Let me abuse the chair prerogative and ask a question to both of you and to Takehara as well. Regarding the trilateral meeting in The Hague, what do you hope will come out of that? And then what do you think will come out of that?
Well, my hope is that the first and most important thing is that a photograph will be taken, which will be published in all the papers in Seoul, which will show that it's possible to have contact and communication. In other words, that this crazy distancing, which we've seen for the last year, is no longer a barrier to serious conversations. If beyond that, they can talk a little bit about something substantive, which is what's going on with North Korea, and how are we coordinating policies? And even more important, how are a second, third, and fourth meetings are we going to make sure that we have a common policy on North Korea? That's what I'd like to see coming out of The Hague.
I agree. It's been an absolute anomaly that the two leaders have not talked to each other so far.
So the meeting itself has a lot of value, and they should not talk about the divisive issue from the beginning. North Korea, as Joe mentioned, is a perfect subject to talk. And come to think of it, it was only in 1998 when President Kim Dae-jun came to Japan and made a moving speech at the Japanese Diet, saying that our history is over. We will be stepping forward for a new era. It's only 10 and a couple of years ago, and we must find a start, emotional start, to go back to that stage.
So I think it is a very big opportunity to take advantage of for all the leaders. So I really hope that a clear-cut statement will be made on the part of the colonizer that a square-up apology will be made again, and for the colonized to accept the apology.
I'm from the Korea, the monthly chosen here, the writer. I have a question to the Yukio Okamoto-san. You said around the sixth generation, now it's getting better and better. I don't think so. It's getting worse and worse. Because we believe after, this is some small comment, after the Abe, it's getting much more worse. Because you said right now, the President Kim, he said a moving speech about the future, going to the future. But because he said at that time, after he heard that the Gono statement, Gono, right? But now the Abe, he said he wants to reverse go back. Of course, officially he said he doesn't want to do that. But now, because facing the trilateral summit, and then he changed suddenly. Korean people, they don't forget that. But you said, oh, we heard the President Kim's very moving speech. But they say now the different story. But Koreans say it. That is the kind of, you know, the endless speech going worse and worse. This is the current situation. And then also you said that the trilateral meeting, I'm sorry, a little bit, I'm excited. Before the Korean, they released that trilateral meeting, 2 days before, actually, they released the meeting between China and Korea. So you said, Professor Nye, that will be covered broadly in the Korean newspaper? I don't think so. Maybe the much more bigger portal will be released in Korean paper between Xi Jinping and Madam Park. Actually, I don't like that. A lot of Korean people, they worry about that. But no choice now. The given the general situation between Japan and Korea, Korea, you know, they are pushed in some way. They don't want to go that world. A lot of people actually don't want to go that direction. This is the current situation. That's just a little bit comment, and if you have something adding to that, my idea, please let me know that.
Again, hopefully a quick question. Two quick questions to Dr. Nye. You've been known as probably most articulate critic of the Abe's Yasukuni Shrine visit in Japan, and at least in Japanese press. But why? My question, do you see any merit of the public administration going public, publicly scolding the leader of an important ally for paying tribute to its own country? Well, that's one question. The other one is, why is it that American critics, including yourself, pay almost no attention to what Mr. Abe publicly said about the intention of his visit to the Yasukuni Shrine? The first time that he ever issued a statement, both in Japanese and English, and covering all those contentious points that critics raise. It's a peaceful purposes, no war, no a lot of remorse, no respect for the war, class A war criminal and all that. And you seem to give more credence to what the Koreans and Chinese said based on suspicion than the what the leader, democratically elected leader of the important ally, officially states in writing.
Well, first, with regard to the first question, well, I think you misunderstood me. When I said about sixth generation, I was mentioning about sixth generation in China. People of those 40 years, people like Hu Xianfa, Sun Chongzai, these people who were educated under a relatively free atmosphere, when Japan and China were at their honeymoon under Mr. Hu Yaban and Mr. Nakasone, my judgment is that people educated during this period, whom I said will become the Politburo members in the 20th Party Congress, will have a quite different view towards Japan. But you raise a very interesting question, because in my personal view, in Korea it's reverse. Koreans in their 40s are more anti-Japanese than other generations. Those generations who used to be called 369 generation. I think it is easier to develop, to restore friendship with China than in Korea, unless something has to change in Korea. This deep-seated animosity, such as hailing the Mr. An Ju-gon's assassination of Japanese Prime Minister, now the big posters of this man covers the entire Korean stadium and making young people even more agitative. Recently there was the Memorial Museum built in the station of Harbin in China. I'm not questioning the fact that Mr. An Ju-gon is treated as a national hero in Korea. But to build such a thing at the point of assassination tend to send the wrong message. So unless you have Korean government has a serious intention to improve the relationship with Japan, it's not easy to come by. Japanese are always ready. We have no, well, because admittedly, we were the persecutors, okay? We were the ones to be apologetic. We have little hurdles to improve our relationship with Korea.
Well, on the question of the U.S. statement, the government statement, that it was disappointed by Prime Minister's visit to the shrine, I think that has to be put in the context of the fact that the U.S. and Japan are allies, that we face two important problems together. One is the difficult problem of North Korea, in which we need to get cooperation with South Korea if we're to be effective. And the second is the larger question of how we manage the challenge of a rise of China. The United States government officials, from the very high levels to very modest levels, and many, many non-governmental friends of Japan had spoken with Mr. Abe a number of times and said, as allies, your visit to the Yasukuni Shrine, your statements about the Kono statement and the Murakami statement are defeating our common purpose as allies. You're undercutting what we're trying to do together, which is as allies. And I think what the Prime Minister did was defy that. And if that's the case, why shouldn't an ally say, if we're in a joint venture and you've just made our joint venture more difficult, we are disappointed, which is a modest word in diplomatic language, but makes clear that it was indeed an undercutting of a joint alliance purpose. Now, that's the government, what the government did. As for my personal statements, as somebody who has been known as a friend of Japan for a long time, I believe that when you see a friend making a mistake and hurting himself, a friend warns him that he's doing something which is against his own interests. And in that sense, I was willing to make statements when asked by various members of the Japanese press what I thought of the Yasukuni Shrine visit. I said, you have defeated yourself. You heard me praise Prime Minister Abe's package this morning. What I criticized was the ways in which he presents that package. Why he does that, you'll have to answer. What could be done about it? I would hate to say to a representative of Sankei that there was an editorial in Mainichi this past week which said maybe the Prime Minister should decide not to revisit the shrine while he's in official office, but should investigate other ways in which Japan can pay proper homage to war dead, not just from the World War II, but from previous wars, without raising the issues that have become so extraordinarily divisive in East Asia. That's the symbol of Yasukuni. And in that sense, it would be in Japan's self-interest to find a way to do this. And I think that friends of Japan should point that out. And apparently, Mainichi understands that.
Thank you. Running out of time, and I would like to conclude this public session at this stage. But as a co-organizer, I would like to thank the panelists for the morning session as well as this second session. And I would like to express a deep appreciation for the other panelists. And thank you very much. I do not intend to give a sort of summary of the meeting or the wrap-up remarks, but Ralph, would you like to say a few words?
I would just also like to thank all of you for coming. I think it's been a very productive time. I would like to comment perhaps on the one comment about the U.S. being disappointed and then the Japanese being disappointed about the U.S. disappointment. I think what is of concern to me in this area is that many Japanese are now interpreting the U.S. disappointment not as a reflection of U.S. disappointment with what Japan had done, because, as Joe says, it undermines our mutual effort, but somehow as a symbol that the U.S. is kowtowing to China or yielding to China pressure. And that, quite frankly, is insulting to an ally. I think it's much more useful to sort of reflect on what the true motives are, and I think you've heard those very clearly from Joe today. It's also extremely frustrating to me. I spend a lot of time in Korea. Our organization for many years has worked on the, quote, virtual alliance, trying to bring U.S., Japan, and Korea closer together. And every conversation I have with someone from Korea starts off with the comment, well, it's Abe's fault because he has renounced the Kono Statement and the Moriyama apology. And I would then say, you know, I must have missed that because actually I heard Abe say just the opposite. And the response traditionally is, yeah, but that's not really what he believes. What he really wants to do is to do that. And I think that there is a frustration in Japan today that when Mr. Abe does say the right thing, that it does not seem to make the newspapers. And when he says something, normally ad-libbing, that says, well, you know, I'm not sure about this or that, that becomes the headline. It becomes official policy. As someone who is dedicated the last 30 or 40 years of his life to trying to bring the trilateral relationship, but closer together. I would hope particularly the members of the media in both countries would be a little bit more diligent in reporting the facts, in reporting not what you think he thinks, but reporting what is actually being said, and maybe that will help us move that relationship forward in the long term. Thank you all very much for coming. I want to express my great gratitude to all of the speakers for a very stimulating morning. We look forward here for the next day and a half to a closed-door dialogue, and we will be publishing on our website the results of that. So once again, thank you all very much. We appreciate your coming. Thank you.